She's so simple. So everything you get is going to be from the side?
Thank you. regathering our shared sense of grief and loss, for in that gathering we find comfort and support from one another. But we also gather in thanksgiving and gratitude for all that we have shared with him. And in faith we gather knowing that he's found hope to be with the dawn. And so in spirit, in his soul, he continues to be very much present with us today. In the waters of baptism, Jim died with Christ and rose with him to new life. May he now share with him eternal glory. Let us pray. Almighty God and Father, it is our certain faith that your Son, who died on the cross, was raised in the dead, the firstfruits of all who have fallen asleep. Grant that through this mystery, your servant Jim, who has gone to his rest in Christ, may share in the joy of the resurrection. We ask this to our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. I now invite you to be seated as we begin our liturgy of the word, and our first reading will be read to us by Jim Hansen.
A reading from the book of Sirach. Now I will praise For reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, for no one lives for oneself, and no one dies for oneself. For if we live, we live for the Lord, and if we die, we die for the Lord. So then, whether we live or we die, we are the Lord's. For this is why Christ died and came to life, that he might be the Lord of both the dead and the living. Why do you then judge a brother or sister? Or you, why do you look down on your brother or sister? For we shall all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written,
as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bend before me, and every tongue shall give praise to God. So then each of us shall give an accounting of himself to God. The word of the Lord.
Please rise.
Such as literature, science, medicine, and so on. And the inspiration behind this foundation was Alfred Nobel. In the late 1800s, his family ran the old engineering works, and he was a prolific designer and creator of things. Maybe amongst the best known kinds of things that he is noted for is the development of things like jelly knife, dynamite, and the infamous Bofa machine gun that was used to such devastating effects in the World War, the First World War, and the Second World War. His reasons for Cristo set not this foundation, however, were less than altruistic. He had, as things advanced, become quite wealthy, so he took his wife and his children to Paris on holidays. And while there, his brother Ludwig died suddenly at home. And the journalist for the Le Monde newspaper in Paris thought it was Alfred himself and wrote his obituary. And it was a very scathing obituary, calling him a purveyor of death and destruction, doctor death, and so on. And so when Alfred Nobel read his own obituary, he was shocked to the very core. So he went home and he continued to work in his family engineering business. But at his death, he amassed, or he bequeathed most of his vast fortune and wealth to the setting up of this foundation that would work to promote peace and reconciliation and harmony in the world. Now, it is unlikely that any of us here today are going to read our obituary in the Chicago Tribune of the Southern Times. But maybe in an imaginative way, it might be a good exercise to take time to think about maybe our own legacy and the footprint we leave behind for having been here. Because as we live in relationship with one another, in how we engage in the world around us, we are creating our own legacy and our own footprint. So to share something of the legacy and the footprint that Jim left behind, I now invite Randall to come forward and to share something of Jim's life and his legacy that he has bequeathed to us.
Good afternoon, everybody. Good to see a nice group of people together, even though I can only see half your faces. I can tell who most of you are. And if I pretended like I did, I did. For those of you that don't know me, my name is Randy Frederick. I'm Jim's son-in-law. I married Margaret, Jim's youngest child. And our daughter Anita is here also, Jim's youngest grandchild. As I look out here, I see a lot of people who knew Jim from the later part of his life, I call it the third act. And I'm talking about the part where he had no choice but to accept large, loud, extended families. So let's back up a little and tell you about his humble beginnings and the stories he told me himself, and some I just learned the last few days from all of his children. James Michael Steele was born in 1933 on the west side of Chicago to Connie and James. They were very poor. Then on top of that, his father left when he was very young to find work in the coal mines of West Virginia. So Connie was now a single mother. She had help raising him from various aunts and uncles. His uncle Mickey was a carpenter who lived to be 100 years old, so that's where he got his line from. He eventually gained a stepfather, Dimitri, and these two men are primarily responsible for most of his carpentry skills and do-it-yourself built into him. Jim hated being poor, and at a young age, he had to work many odd jobs to make ends meet. At 13, he was driving an ice truck. He told me a story of how the guy hired him, and back then, there were no background checks. He just said, yeah, I can drive a truck. And the guy believed him until he hit a fruit stand and demolished it. But then I guess the guy liked him so much he kept him on. He also cleaned airplanes at Midway Airport, and he also went to barber school, for those of you who don't know that. There was a picture in his washroom for years in black and white of him in barber school. He even tried to lie about his age and tried to join the military as the war was ending, but his mom caught him because the band-aid on his arm was there from drawing the blood. A few years later, he met the love of his life, Anita Watkins. He said she tried many times to take her out, but she refused. Eventually, she gave in. I guess a friend of Anita's kept telling her, you should date Jim, you should date Jim. He's a good kisser, he's a good kisser. So she did, and when Jim laid the first kiss on her, she backed up and said, "That wasn't so great." They were married at the ripe old ages of 17 and 19. Anita was 19. Older women, huh, Margaret? You had to be 18 in Illinois to get married, unless you were pregnant. Jim wanted her to lie and say she was, but she refused. So they had to go over to Missouri and get married. Jim eventually went on to college and started to work in the mail room at Chicago and Northwestern Railroad, where Anita's father worked. Jim and Anita had their first child, Patricia, in 1950, and then came Mike in 1956. While raising kids with Anita, Jim was enrolled at DePaul University, where he eventually earned his master's degree in accounting. Then eventually rose through the ranks to corporate vice president. I now see where they get the story for those old black and white movies. In 1962, Jim was looking to the suburbs and saw a house in Norris for sale. He liked it so much, he pulled over, took the sign out of the lawn, and put it in his trunk, I heard. He then negotiated a price, wrote up a contract, and bought it. Simpler times, huh? You know, through the years, Jim took a lot of people shopping for cars. Me, I got my first car with him, and that's where I learned you gotta walk away. We also took my sister once, and she cried as we left because she didn't understand that walk away part. We told her she was gonna get it eventually down the line. So in 1965, after a gap of about 9 years, came his third child, Katie. And 4 years after Katie came Margaret, my wife, the baby of the family. Kate's mentioned many times how she was the one who had to discipline Maggie, because Jim and Anita were all out of discipline by now, mainly from using it on Pat and Mike, so Kate says. The whole family has told me many times about their fun family vacations to Wisconsin, Canada, Florida, and a camper RV. Jim loves family time so much, and he cherished these vacations. I saw it firsthand in many of their old movies. He was always building their addition or fixing something. He was the kind of guy that just refused to have someone when you could do it yourself. It's not like living next door to Johnny Marr in my apartment. Time moved on, years went by. Marriages for Pat and Mike came and went. Son-in-laws and daughter-in-laws came and went. Grandchildren were born and raised. So, Jim loved these times, and he loved the family more than anything. I met Margaret November 93. She brought me to her parents at Christmas. Jim had just recovered from a heart attack and later would go on to have quintuple surgery. My mom said I should bring a bottle of wine or something, so I did. Big brother Mike still makes fun of me to this day. "Oh, here you go, Mr. and Mrs. Steele, with a bottle of wine." I remember Jim asking me that night, "Hi, nice to meet you. What do you do?" Well, I was working in the city of Chicago and I was repairing medical equipment for the fire department. And all he heard was the word medical. Very interested. His eyes opened wide. He said, "Are you in the medical field?" I said, No, don't get your hopes up. As I grew closer to Margaret, I grew closer to her family. Many nights I would sleep over, but Jim always said, "On the couch, buddy." Eventually, I was allowed to sleep on the floor in Maggie's room, but the door had to stay wide open. So in 96, I joined the fire department. As you know, we work one on, two off. So I spent many days with Jim, remodeling the kitchen and doing many, many other projects. He loved my time off more than I did. He taught me a lot about life and even more about love of family. He was a very spiritual man who also loved his church and never stopped giving back. Many of you remember the fun nights at the Pine Savior Bingo Tent where he was in charge of the accounting and his wife Anita ran the bingo tent. Fun times had by all. He lost the love of his life suddenly on November in 1996. I remember seeing the pain in his and his family's faces, but finally they're together again up there. I married Margaret in 99, and a few nights after the wedding, I was sleeping over again. And as we went in her bedroom, the door was open, I was in shorts, and I said, "He's in the kitchen alone." And I remember stepping out of the kitchen and looking at him saying, "Jim, we're married now, and tonight I'm closing the door." It was then that Jim started to see just how big his extended family was about to get. He wasn't used to big parties of 25, 30 people or more, but he got used to it. He learned to enjoy it. The great thing is how much everyone in my family fell in love with him and his family and enjoyed his company. He pretty much became a pillar. When he wasn't there, everyone would always say, "Where's Jim?" They loved him. He then spent many good years as a good friend of my mother. And after my mother moved on, he spent a lot of time in Florida with Wilfred Digby, who's here now, and we all know as Willie. The last couple of years, Mike had lived with his dad and spent most of the time with him. Mike is blind, for those of you who don't know, and Mike tells many stories about how his dad would say, "Mike, I need you to go in the other room and get that folder." And Mike would say, "What folder?" And Jim would say, "The blue one, or the red one." What a last year of life he gets, the COVID year. The last week and a half were very hard on his whole family. But he said many times that he didn't want to pass away in the hospital. So Katie set up hospice, and I watched and helped as Katie, Mike, Maggie, daughter-in-law Julie, nephew Jim, and friend of Margaret's, Lisa Quinn, stood by and prayed and helped all they could. There were many sleepless nights for a lot of them. Jim passed peacefully on the morning of March 9th with his children around him, and he is now reunited with his wife, Anita. Is there any other better way to go? When this pandemic finally ends, hug everyone. Hug everyone and tell them to love them, because that's what Jim would have wanted. And continue to celebrate Jim's life. Thank you.
Jesus, in his own Aramaic language, when he was talking about God, called him Father. But that translates into Abba, or what we would say is Daddy. That's the kind of familiar intimacy that Jesus shared with his Father, and where we too, as adopted sons and daughters of God, are invited to share in that same familiar love. And that's what we go back to. And as Jesus reminds us, the way home, that homecoming, is in relationship with Him. So that inviting the Lord into our lives and living out of that relationship, we continue to be united with those we have known and loved in life and who have found home to be with the Lord. And so when our time comes to lie in the casket in front of the altar, We go back to being united with those we have known and loved in our lives. And I'd like to just finish with a reflection. You may have heard of it. It's called the train of life. Life is like a journey on a train with stations, with changes of routes, and with accidents. At birth, we board the train and meet our parents. We believe they will always travel by our side. However, at some station, our parents step down from the train, leaving us on this journey alone. As time goes by, other people will board the train, and they will be significant. Our siblings, our friends, children, and even the love of our lives. Many will step down and leave a permanent vacuum. Others will go unnoticed, that we don't realize we have vacated their seats. This is very sad when you think about it. The train ride will be full of joy, of sorrow, fantasy, expectations, and always goodbyes and farewells. Success consists of having a good relationship with all the passengers, requiring that we give the best of ourselves. The mystery to everyone is, we do not know which station we ourselves will step down, so we must live in the best way, to love, to forgive, and offer the best of who we are. It is important to do this because when the time comes for us to step down and to leave our empty seat, we should leave behind beautiful memories for those who continue to travel on the train of life.
I invite us all to stand now for the prayers of the faithful, and we invite Anita, Josh, Melissa, Abby, Liz, and Drew to come forward and walk around.
For all people of faith throughout the world, may our faith and the love God has for us be shared with all. Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have died, may they know the peace and fullness of eternal life with God. Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who are sick, lonely, and depressed, may they be strengthened by God's love and aided by friends and family.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all the guests gathered today, in person or virtually, may they enjoy the warm company of family and friends now and forever. Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our world and its leaders, may all people be treated with the dignity they deserve as God's children. Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And just for a moment, in the silence of our own hearts, that each of us make that prayer.
Lord God, giver of peace and healer of souls, hear the prayers of the Redeemer, Jesus Christ, and the voice of your people, whose lives were purchased by the blood of the Lamb. Forgive the sins of all who sleep in Christ, and grant them a place in your kingdom. Make this prayer and all our prayers through Christ our Lord. Amen. I now invite you to be seated and we continue with our interviews.
Thank you.
brothers, let us stand out and let us pray together. Thanksgiving for these gifts. Be near, O Lord, we pray, to your servant, Jim, on whose funeral day we offer you the sacrifice of reconciliation, so that should any stain of sin have come to him, or any human fault have affected him, it may by your loving gift be forgiven and wiped away. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with
your spirit. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying may be consoled by the promise of immortality. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for us in heaven. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we attain. Especially the most blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God,
blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint Eugene and all the saints in whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for our faith in heaven. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, which your servant Francis, our Pope, lays our bishop, the order of bishops and clergy, and the entire people you gave to be your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before. In your compassion and merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. Remember your servant James, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that he who was united with your Son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection, when from the dead he will raise up with the flesh those who have died, and transform our lowly bodies after the pattern of his own glorious body. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, when you will wipe away every tear from our eyes. For seeing you, our God, as you are, we shall be like you, and for all the ages, and praise you without end, through Christ our Lord, to whom you bestow in the world all that is good. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Thank you.
We'd like to thank our co-workers, that if it wasn't for you, it wouldn't happen. We can't wait to take you out for beers, a lot of them. And we just want to thank everyone that showed us all this love through texts and calls and food. My God, the food. That's all I gotta say. We got it for years now. And we're welcoming you to the cemetery. It's a great site, it's outside. Please feel free if you would like to join us. We would love to have you. And there's one more person that we'd really like to thank. And this is where we try not to lose it. My friend for 30 years, who's just stood by our side the whole time. She didn't go home. We did shifts with my dad. Somebody was always there. Somebody was always talking. It couldn't have been any better. And we just want to thank you from the bottom of our hearts. And we're always here for you. And thank you for being here for us.
And normally, tradition in my family, and I'm sure many families is, you know, we're Irish, we're Italian, we're Lithuanian, so we invite you to a restaurant and we'd all get together and celebrate and have drinks with an open bar, but this COVID thing has really prevented us from doing it. So what we're going to plan to do is approximately a year from now, we'll all gather and we'll have a big party and a big celebration, because we really just want to hug each and every one of you. And thank you so much. So thank you all.
Willie, thank you.